get started. We're doing the Megascore 3D. We're doing all our past changes that we've done last year. Future features and updates on specific features. So, who are we? I'm Ken Calder, and this is James Murray. We write the firmware for the Megascore 3 system. What is Megascore 3? Everyone's been talking about it all morning, so just engine management system covering lots of cost options, all the way from kind of DIY all the way up to professional options. What's firmware? Firmware is the software that runs on the ECU that runs your engine. So the firmware is the software that actually is running your engine. So feature highlights.
Okay, so yeah, we're just going to cover here. We're not going to cover everything because there's an awful lot of detailed changes that we've made over the last year and a half or so while we've been putting 1.4 together. So what we're going to do in a presentation here to hopefully keep it brief, keep you awake, is going to cover some of the highlights, which one of them is change to closed loop boost control, which is using a bias table. I'll go into that in some more detail. Some of the VVT changes that have been made for greater engine support. Flex fuel changes to give us greater options on that, the table blendings, stuff we can do there. You want to move to the next one? Also cover some of the CAN enhancements that I put in there with broadcasting, receiving, IO box, and additional CAN devices, and not retype them. So I'm just going to move on to specific highlights and go through those in some more detail. So, okay.
All right, so starting with boost control, the changes I made in boost control. Before I go into the changes, a lot of people who do boost control, they just want to run open loop, which means they've got a table where they just set the duty on the solenoid to give them the boost they want, and that's all they do. And it's very simple, but it's also very, it's not very sophisticated. There's a lot of things you can't do with it. You can't actually target a specific, boost, like a range of boost numbers. You just kind of, you get what you get, and if you want to change it, you have to change the duty. With closed loop, you can actually, once you tune in all the tables and you've got it all working, you can change which boost targets you want on the fly. So you can use features like boost by gear, boost by speed, target blending, and all kinds of stuff like that, and actually target a specific like PSI or KPA number.
Just on that, say if you're using the drag racing application or any other things where you might say, well, in first gear I can only get up to 150 kPa before I blow the tyres away. The closed loop boost makes it a lot easier. You can tune it for 150, and then you say first gear, I want 150. Second, third gear, I want 200, 250. And it'll then, with the right tuning, you can then say that's the target, and that's the target it runs to. So that's a particular benefit of doing it that way. You get greater option for tunability, and we'll come back to it later on.
Alright, so go back into the boost control settings here. What I've done here is I've turned on boost control. Most of the rest of this is defaults. Minimum and maximum duty are very important. I've got them set to 0 and 100 right now. These need to actually be set to the, the minimum needs to be set to the smallest number that will actually make a change to the boost. And the maximum needs to be set to the largest number that will actually make a change to the boost. So if I've got it set to 100, but between 80 and 100, it doesn't actually make any difference. I need to set it to 80 for the max. It's really important later because when you start trying to tune closed loop, if the closed loop algorithm is making a bunch of changes and nothing's happening, then when it goes to, when you want to change the boost target, it has to say you want to reduce boost, for example, and you've just increased it. We'll have to go through all of that dead area in the response before it'll actually make any difference. So you need to actually make sure that those are set correctly. Boost control lower limit coolant threshold, 170. I just have it set there. It's good to tune on a warm engine first. You can lower that later if you want to. By default, this setting here will come out of the box at 100. I would set it to 50 to 60. What that is as boost climbs, up to your, you guys see that? As boost is climbing up to your target, when you get 50 kPa away from your target, it'll actually start trying to control the boost. Prior to that, it'll hold the way state completely closed. It'll try to spool as fast as possible.
So I mean, that in itself is a change. It's fairly recently made.
Right.
To try and make it sort of a little bit more responsive, whereas before we looked at what was on the table. So if you've got it set to hold the wastegate half open, it could take a while to spool up. Whereas the change now to keep the wastegate shut, give you maximum spool so you can get to your targets as quickly as possible.
And it also helps things be more consistent, easier to tune. So I've got it set to closed loop. Normally what you'll do is you'll start in setup mode. In setup mode, this slider and none of these numbers actually do anything. And what you end up doing in setup mode is you just want to tune your target table first. So I've got my target table here. On the y-axis, I've got throttle position, and on the x-axis, I've got RPM. And on the z-axis is my boost targets. So in this particular case, say at full throttle, I've got it set for no boost at idle, and then from 2000, I've got 150 kPa and so on, and I've got it ramping up to full boost by 4000 RPM.
As with everything else, these are all in absolute kPa, so if it was 100, that's no boost.
Right. Right, I just set it to zero here, but yeah. You want this set to 100. And then I've got the bias duty table here. So basically what this is, on the x-axis here, y-axis here, you've actually got the targets that you're trying to hit from this table represented over here. And what you, so like in this case 230 was my max, so let's just change that to 230, and we'll have a little room for growth up top here. But basically what this means is that across this row here, you want to put in the duty it takes to get the boost that you're trying to get to. So for example, at 2000 RPM over here, I'm trying to get 200 kPa, and I'm going to say 35% duty will give you that. So you do that for this, it's really important that when you're doing this that you have this whole table tuned for the values that you have over here. So you've got, in this table I've got everything between 100 and 230. So that means that this table needs to go from 100 to 230. And basically this is, up to this point when you're tuning, this is more like open loop than it is anything else, because you're trying to give boost control a place to start when it first actually turns on, a place to start. So it's like a hint. It's almost exactly the same as when you're tuning your VE table. That's kind of like tuning this bias table, and then you tune closed loop EGO control, and that's almost the same as tuning closed loop boost. You're giving a starting point, and then it'll correct it from there.
I mean, the key point on here as well is that we're actually giving it, whereas in the original open loop, you just got a table that said, if I'm at full throttle at 3000 RPM, I want this much duty in the solenoid. That was it. Whereas here you can say, I want 200 kPa, and in the bias table we say, when we're at 3000 RPM, we want 200 kPa, this is the duty that we need. If you want 250 kPa, this is the duty we need. If you want 150 kPa, that's the duty you need. So there's more tuning points, but it means you've mapped all those areas. So if you want to change the boost target to a specific RPM, you've got data in the ECU to do it. Whereas with open loop, you can't do that.
Right, so then your next step here is to switch to basic mode, which will make this slider here active. And what you do is you start tuning, try to go into boost, and you just keep increasing this until you start to get a little bit of oscillation. And once you get that oscillation, back it off just slightly, and that's the number you want to end up with for your sensitivity. For a lot of people, this will actually be all you have to do. You'll be done at that point. If you have kind of a more strange setup, something that spools really fast, for example, or the wrong size turbo for your engine, I've got a guy up in Maryland where I'm from who's got an RX-7 that's high compression with a really tiny turbo. Because he wants it to spool at 2,000 RPM, that guy is going to be an interesting one to tune. So I'll probably need to go use advanced mode, which all advanced mode does is it enables these proportional integral and derivative gains, and you can actually fine tune exactly how it responds to boost increasing and how it holds boost. So like in the case of that guy's engine, it's going to spool really fast at 2,000 RPM, and it's going to drop off as the RPMs climb. You can make it do everything possible to try to hold that boost up to the red line by like turning up the I-turn really high and having it like track. So kit tuning is kind of out of scope for what I wanted to go over today. But the main point of the new feature is that I've now got this this bias table, which lets me try to give a hint to Pit as to where to start with the duty. So that you can basically tune the PIDs really tight and get them to really hold the target if you give it this hint ahead of time.
The way I look at it on there is it's kind of like the best of both worlds between open loop and closed loop.
Right.
I know a lot of people said that open loop, well, yeah, it works, but it's not always exactly on the target, whereas a closed loop, it's a bit too difficult to set up. So hopefully with this method here, because you can give it lots more hints, you can end up with a system that's more achievable but still easy to understand.
Right. And then one last point, the lower limit delta that I was talking about before, I set it to 50 early on in the process. After you've got the bias table tuned, but before you leave setup mode, you want to set this to like somewhere between 20 and 50. Closer to 20 is probably better, because what that allows you to do, one, it holds the wastegate closed longer, so it'll spool faster, and two, it'll let you tune the PIDs tighter once you get up there. So your goal is to try and keep the PIDs so that the PID gain is tuned as, so that the closed loop holds as tight as possible to your target. And the closer you allow it to get to the target before you turn on the detector, after you change this to 20, you may have to tweak these a little bit because you'll probably get a little bit of overshoot. So you just tweak them down a little bit and you'll be fine.
I'm just kind of want to ask you, what you're trying to do then is stop the wastegate from opening till the very last second? Is that the idea?
Because right,
you tend to crack open early.
You keep it closed as long as possible, and then you want it to open really quickly once you're ready for it to open. You want it to go to the right value really quickly so that you don't overshoot.
So I'm saying they tend to crack open early, slightly, and then they catch, and then they open completely.
We're keeping it closed as long as possible, and then you can control when it cracks open by using this lower limit delta. Basically, the closer, the smaller this number, the closer you'll be.
You're saying a mechanical one.
Oh, okay.
Cracks open early, and what you're doing is you're making the hole close
last
instant.
Right, we're trying to keep it closed as long as possible to help you spool faster. If that's not what you want, you can just make that number bigger. Some people want it to spool slower and more smoothly. You can just keep that number larger. It's kind of up to you, but a lot of the drag racers just wanted to get up there as quick as possible. So let's go back to the presentation. So in the presentation here, I just had kind of the basic steps you want to do and not much detail. If you have any more questions, we can go over and just come find me later.
Noticing that Andy's eaten up most of our time. So basically, just here on this slide, those are the key things we're going to go over, so I'm just going to go through this stuff in a bit. So basically, first off is a recap of what CAN is. CAN, basically, is reflexively, is a simple two-wire communication system. It really is, as a user, you don't need to be worried about too much about the mysteries behind it. Hopefully we've dealt with all of that. It allows different ECUs to talk to each other. So we've got here just a slide that shows. So just there's a diagram there where you can have a MX-Work 3 or MX-3 Pro or MX-3 Gold, or possibly MX-2, hooked up to maybe, say, a transmission controller or an ion box or a Canon GT or a third party dash or third-party data logger or other devices might work on the CAN system. So, CAN protocol, so it's MegaSquirt CAN. That's a proprietary system that's used between MegaSquirt devices. It's built in, it's already there, you don't need to worry about it. It uses a custom command and reply system, but it's not supported by a lot of other third-party devices. Standard CAN is a simpler system. It's just broadcast packets with no command and reply. It's used by many OEM systems, aftermarket devices. It's often a little bit encouraging. So on the MegaSquirt CAN, there's a couple of ways that can operate. The first one here is called device to device. So say if you've got a transmission controller, it can just talk to you main ECU pointer, not only for a laptop, not only for anything else. It just sends what RPM we're running at, what gear we want to be in, whatever, and it just, the two of the ECUs talk to each other. Then pointed out here, to and fro is a bit of an Englishism, but it belongs to the nursery school, anyway. So the other way that Megaswork can work is what's called pass-through. So that way, if you've got your tuning computer hooked up to your main ECU, you can talk over the CAN and you can tune your, say, transmission control or other device without having to keep swapping plugs around. You can just talk through to pass-through. So on the existing Megaswork CAN, there's a fairly complicated dialogue there. I'm not going to go through any settings on that, but that's just what it looks like, so you can configure the Megaswork 3 to pick up different stuff. So standard CAN. Why is it used by OEMs? There's a lot of aftermarket devices use it. It's a standard way for them to configure stuff, to read standard stuff off your ECU, RPM, whatever, and show that on your dash. It's a low-level protocol. A lot of the time, OEM stuff isn't well documented, so whilst they're using CAN, finding out what they're doing, as was mentioned earlier, saying the Mustang Dash, yes, it's there, it's using CAN, but to actually find that information can be a bit of a problem. So, we've got in the firmware at the moment support for a limited number of broadcasts where customers have provided for us information about some BMW and some Alfa Romeo. We've had the data for that. The simple settings there, we can turn it on, and those supported devices on the stock vehicle will then receive data from the Megaswork. So, an enhancement to this version is what we call real-time data broadcasting. So that enables all of your standard stuff that you get in the data log, RPMs, pulse width, speeds, wheel speed, all the stuff that's coming into ECU can be sent out on CAN, and then with certainly other third-party devices, you can then pick that up. As I mentioned there in the notes, if you're using your Arduino guy, the standard libraries with those microcontrollers, they will use standard CAN. Megaswork CAN is difficult, but standard CAN, they're fine. So if you want to build your own device to read stuff for Megaswork, this real-time data broadcasting is the stuff to use, the only bit counts what you want. And there's a protocol document for that you can download. You can easily use as a DBC format that defines how it all works. There's part of the settings screen for it. It's fairly complicated, there's a lot of different fields. So based on that, we've then been doing some work with some of the third-party dash guys we've got, and have worked on a simplified version. So, let's go to the next slide. It just picks out highlights and fields that you want to put on a dash. You haven't got all the other stuff, you've got four settings pages, you've got whatever it is, 60 different settings to choose. It's a simple on-off configuration. Currently we've got Race Technology coming over to their headquarters in the UK, did some work with them supporting it. And the guys from DIY Altitude who work with Race Pack. There's a CAN adapter for all the Race Pack stuff, so if you want a Race Pack dash, you can use that with Megaswork. With any of the Megaswork 2 or Megaswork 3 products, you can use Race Pack with that. I've been in touch with them recently, and I believe they've encoded that into their systems as well. And again, protocol documents really available. So for dash broadcasting, there's just one setting. You turn it on. That's it. No, nothing else. You can choose the advanced mode and what it sends it out on, but basically, just turn it on, it's done. That's it. Fine. So CAN receiving is another new feature. This actually came from one of our long-time Megaswerkers, Peter Florence. He's on a BMW race car he works on. They're using a Teams 4 ABS unit, and that broadcasts on the CAN 4 wheel speed sensor information. So he said, well, I really could do with how can I get that into the Megaswerk? So again, got the data, implemented this CAN receiving system, and with that now you can receive that standard CAN information that's coming out of that ABS module. It doesn't interfere with the ABS module, it's listening to what's on the network, and then can read it in, bring it into a Megaswerk data log. You can use it for traction control or any launch features that depend on wheel speed. I think he's using, it's not a non-drag race one, but you can apply timing based on wheel speed and stuff like that. So there's options to do that. That's there now. It only really goes into VSS or the ABC inputs at the moment. Potential for the future at least to extend that to do more stuff. So that's the screen. It's fairly complicated. With any receiving, it's going to be, because there's so many different options, so many different IDs, different byte sizes, different offsets. So probably not for the new app. So another new device that's come along that Ken uses CAN is the MicroStrand IOBox, being touched on briefly earlier on. This is a free firmware update for MicroStrand, by MicroStrand, load the firmware and plug it into your MicroStrand 3. And you can use it as an IO extension box. Don't need to do any modifications inside, no soldering. Just hook it up and you've got wheel speed inputs, you've got analog inputs, as they're on the list there, and you've got switch outputs. So it's kind of neat. It's off the shelf, buy it off your favourite distributor, plug it in and go. It's the ideal. Full size here, there's pretty much no configuration. You turn it on, the MicroStrand 3, once you turn it on, MicroStrand 3 knows about it, all the settings, configuration is all done through the MicroStrand 3. You don't have to have a CAN device from Tune Studio, you don't have to put different tuning cables. There aren't even any settings on it, it doesn't let you change anything. Everything's done through the MicroStrand 3. Just try and make it easy to use, plug it in, get on with it, and use it. Another recent feature, it's been around for a while, but been a growing number of users of it, is transmission control on the MicroStrand. So we've got a number of transmissions supported, GM4L80E, been in use for many, many years, 4R60, 1440, as you can see there, 4R70W, some there that are in development. I think, don't know if he's still here today, but the guy was here yesterday on the, with the 4WA33 gearbox. That's fine, it shifts, a few electrical issues which are going to be a vehicle install. Again, buy MicroStrand, follow the instructions that are with there, it's one of these supported gearboxes, plug it in and go. And don't need to pay any extra. Another thing that I've been working on over the last year or so is documentation updates. Don't know if many of you have seen this. For MS2 Extra and MS3, the documentation has all been rewritten. It's a PDF format so you can download it. You can use it away from Wi-Fi, you don't have to have an internet connection to look at it. Download it, put it on your laptop, use it at the track. Certainly where I am, anytime I go to the track, there's no signal. There's no Wi-Fi, there's no data signal. There's no point in me trying to get on the internet, not going to happen. So you can download the manuals, you can view them online, you can view them offline rather. They're also linked into Tune Studio. When you're on a settings page, you can go to help and it'll automatically load up that PDF manual at the right place and give you a bit more information about the settings that are on that page. And the key point there, which is for some of my guys, please do read the manual. I've spent a lot of effort trying to write it. And so when I get messages from people saying, hey, how do you do this? It's like, missing his name out. Read the manual, it's there. So, hopefully those are helpful to you. So, that's basically where we are on 1.4. There's a lot more stuff we put in there, but we didn't want to go into the details about every single detailed feature we've added. So I just want to now pick up, I think Ken's going to go through some of the upcoming stuff that we're looking to put into 1.5 version of firmware. Again, with this, there'll be many, many more detailed little features, but we just want to go through one feature that I think could make the MicroStrand experience easier to set up for our customers.
Right. So this is engine states. So currently a bunch of features that we have right now, like overrun fuel cut, let's say idle, anything having to do with idle speed control, idle advance, idle VE, you know, a bunch of these features kind of depend on the state that your engine's in, right? Are you in idle state? Are you in cruise state? Are you in, are you in overrun state? And so the problem is that all of these different features each have their own settings to tell the code when to turn them on. So like, you know, overrun will have like a throttle position and a map and an RPM and a bunch of other features. And idle speed control has all of those too to turn it on. And idle VE and all those, so all those features each have their own set of settings here that turn those various things on. And with that, it causes a number of problems, right? One, it makes it a lot harder for people to tune because they have to tune all these settings over and over again. And two, people will often tune them to have different on points and different off points. So like idle speed control will come on a second before the idle advance comes on. And then when idle advance comes on, it throws off idle speed control. Or like people turn on overrun fuel cut with idle speed control, and we'll get into a situation where overrun fuel cut is still on when idle speed control comes on, and then idle speed control will come on and try to turn idle speed up, but there's no fuel, so it can't. And then when the fuel comes back, it'll suddenly, the idle valves open too much, and you get into an oscillation where it just goes up and down, on and off the fuel cut. I've seen that happen, stuff like that happen a number of times. So what we're doing to resolve this is I'm taking away all those settings from all those features, and I'm giving you one set of settings to determine, is the engine in cruise state? Is it in idle state? Is it in acceleration or deceleration, or you know, all these different states? And then all these other features will be tied to what state you're in. So anything having to do with idle will only turn on when the engine is in the idle state. And overrun will only turn on when the engine is in overrun state. We'll have a new state called cruise that, you know, you can, there'll be an option for EGO to only turn on when you're in cruise state and not on acceleration or deceleration, stuff like that. And what that'll do is not only will it make it easier to tune, but it'll make everything more consistent with the way the engine runs. So basically, it just, you know, you won't run into, you know, some of these states are kind of mutually exclusive. You can't be in the state, one state and the other state at the same time, which will make it so you won't run into these situations where two things activate at once when they shouldn't, and you get into problems. So it, you know, this is the kind of feature that's going to help a lot of people who are experienced tuning with MS3 and MS2 Extra. Well, we're not actually implementing this on MS2 Extra yet. We're going to test it on MS3. But it'll help anyone who's used to tuning MS3 and having to tune all these different settings. You know, you'll tune at one place, and then you won't ever run into these issues that you used to run into where the features conflict with each other. So that's pretty much it for 1.5.
Yeah.